Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen? Am I audible? Can you see the screen? Hello. Okay. No problem. Okay, can you see the screen? Can you see the screen? Can you hear me? Please unmute to hear our voices. Oh, you can't hear me. No, it's a problem. Okay, can you hear me now? Can you hear me? Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Aisha. Okay, it's recording. Okay, now let me just try sharing screen. Go by this mode. Thank you. Thanks, Naima. Okay. Now we will learn. Okay, you can see the application. Okay, fine. Now we will learn capacity to contract. Now, this also is a simple aspect and it is an interesting aspect. This comes under legal enforceability part of it. Whether how can a contract be enforceable? Another element that would be really checked whether a contract is enforceable or not is whether the parties to the contract are competent to contract. Not the words that I'm using, competent to contract. So the parties to a contract must be competent to contract. Are you understanding? A parties to a contract must be competent to contract. So in the law of contract, parties to the contract must have legal capacity to contract, which means they must be competent to enter into a contract. And that is one of the important elements in contract. So this implies, or this means that the legal ability of the party or parties to the contract to understand the terms of the agreement, contract, and the willingness to enter into the contract. That means the parties to the contract should understand the consequence of their action. They should be able to understand the consequence of of entering into a contract. Next, the parties to the contract must have the legal ability to perceive the contents and the terms of the contract in order to express and affix their willingness to the contract. So what is capacity to contract? Capacity to contract means that the parties to the contract have to be competent enough to contract to understand the implication of entering into the contract, or to understand the consequence, or to understand the effect of entering into contract, or what is the contract about, to understand the implication of entering into the contract. So parties to a contract should be competent in law or have legal capacity to contract. Now, what is contract with a minor? Now, who is a minor? Of course, you know that. generally a minor across the globe, most of the laws say that a minor is any person who is below the age of 18. This is normally a general definition which is given in most of the laws, but again, it differs from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but by and large, a minor would be considered a person who is below the age of 18 years. Now, with respect to marriage, again, it differs again from country to country. For example, in UAE, both the parties, the man and the woman, should be at least 18 years. However, in India, it is the girl should be 18 and the boy should be at least 21. So for marriage contract or for marriage, you enter into a marriage, again, their minority, the definition is something different. However, another example I could give you is in UAE with respect to employment contracts or training contracts. When it comes to training contracts, an individual who is 16 year old can enter into a training contract for the purpose of training or, even for the purposes of job or employment. So now again, the definition with respect to this kind of contract is different in UAE. Now note the difference here. For marriage, both the parties have to be 18. For employment contract, a 16 year old is allowed to contract in UAE. I'm talking about United Arab Emirates. I'm just talking about jurisdictional differences here. That's the reason I'm mentioning about UAE as well. Next is, I spoke about employment in UAE. I spoke about marriage in UAE. Now, the next part of it is that, however, with respect to property in UAE, the party has to be at least 18 years and above. So therefore, who is a minor, it may differ from country to country. However, by and large, it is normally 18 years of age. Now, referring to the Indian contract law. Now, why I'm referring to the Indian contract law is so that because they have given a little bit of, an elaborate definitions that will really help us to understand. So that's the reason I referred first to the Indian contract law. So the validity of a contract with a minor basically revolves around the principle of equity. Reference to the Indian contract law. Pay attention here. Section 11 of the Indian Contract Act states that every person is competent to contract who is of the age of majority according to the law to which he is subject and who is of sound mind, whose mind is normal, and is not disqualified under the law or disqualified from contracting by any law to which he is subject. Now, here they have pointed out three aspects. One is a person would be considered as capable of contracting if he is not a minor. That means he should attain at least 18 years and above. Two, he should be of sound mind. That is, his mind should be normal. He should not be insane or he should not be suffering any disease which would mentally derange him, or he should not suffer dementia or diseases like Alzheimer's disease and so on. Next is he should not be disqualified under any law from contracting. For example, it depends again whether a person who is bankrupt or who is declared by the court as insolvent is permitted to contract. That's an example for you. Therefore, as per the Indian law of contract, a person must not be a minor and a person must attain the age of majority. Secondly, the person must be of a sound mind. And thirdly, must not be disqualified from contracting under law. Example, a person or a company who is declared insolvent. Next is, who is a minor under the Indian law? As per the Indian Majority Act, a contract with a minor that is below the age of majority is surmised as invalid. I'm repeating, a contract with a minor is void ab initio. A contract with a minor is considered as void, V-O-I-D. Void ab initio means something that is null, N-U-L-L, null and void ab initio. That means it cannot be considered as valid or it is invalid. As per the Indian Majority Act 1875, the age of majority is stated as 18 years. Therefore, a contract with a minor is null and void ab initio. ab initio means from the very beginning or from its inception. Just 1 minute, I'm having some problems with my PC. So excuse me, please. Okay, so sorry for that. And the parties in the contract with the minor cannot enforce it. And even after the party attains majority, the same agreement cannot be ratified. However, what should be noted here is that the contract itself may not be regarded as illegal. Understand here, the contract by itself cannot be regarded as illegal, as this aspect is not fortified in law. Are you understanding me? So a contract with a minor would be considered as void ab initio, void from the very beginning. Or you could say that a contract with a minor who has not attained the age of majority is invalid, null, and void ab initio. However, after the person attains majority, the same agreement cannot be ratified as well. That means, what is ratification? That after the person becomes a major, the individual attains majority, the person cannot agree again, cannot ratify, cannot make the contract good. However, what should be noted here is that the contract itself may not be regarded as illegal. It doesn't mean that the contract is illegal, as this aspect is not fortified in law, Indian law, or it is not actually mentioned in Indian law. So the rationale or the reasoning behind minor's contract being void is a presumption that a minor is incapable of rational discernment of the consequences or the implications of entering into a contract. On the other hand, a minor can be made a beneficiary under a contract. Example, say in a partnership firm, the minor may not be admitted as a partner, but he may enjoy the benefits of partnership. A minor may enter a contract through a guardian. That is, he may be represented by a guardian in a contract, but such a contract is for the benefit of the minor, and such a contract can be enforced by the minor. For example, a minor's agreement amounting for necessaries can be enforced. Example, food, etc. That is necessary items. So in the landmark decision of Mohri Bibi versus Dharmadas Ghose, 1903, the Supreme Court held that the contract with a minor is void ab initio. It is null and void ab initio. That means it is invalid. However, contract for beneficiaries may be permitted, and a minor may act through a guardian. And yet another thing is that a minor may be made a beneficiary under a contract. He may be made a beneficiary, or she may be made a beneficiary under a contract, and a contract for necessaries may be held as valid. And the classic or landmark decision for Indian law is Mohri Bibi versus Dharmadas Ghose, where the Supreme Court of India held that contract with a minor is void ab initio. Next is the reference to English law. We are studying it now in international perspective. That's why I've given you examples here. Reference to the English law. As per the Family Law Reforms Act 1969, a minor is one who is under the age of 18. So this is the definition which they have given. So under English law, the contract made with a minor may be, listen carefully, may be void, that means invalid, or voidable, depending upon the circumstances of the case. Now, what is voidable contract? Voidable contract means that the contract can be declared as void at the option of the parties. A void contract means that a contract is inherently unenforceable. Void means it is invalid. Invalid contract cannot be enforced. That means it is inherently unenforceable. Now, in UK, or as per the English law, a contract with a minor, it may be void or voidable. It's voidable because it may be considered valid, but it can be made void at the option of the parties and more so at the option of the minor. So in UK, contract with the minor is not always inherently unenforceable. Now, depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case, but may be valid and then declared void at the option of the party. So therefore here, the law does not forbid contracts with a minor per se, as it is. Now see the difference. Normally, the laws across the globe normally is borrowed from the English law, mostly. And even in India, it's a large part of it borrowed. I mean, most of it is borrowed from the English law. But now here, there is a slight difference. In India, a contract with a minor is void ab initio. It is null and void. It is invalid, but there are exceptions. Now, what are the exceptions? A contract may be entered through a guardian. A contract may be for necessaries.
Hello. What happened? Hello. Hello, Magla. Hello, ma'am.
Hello. Okay, I'm so sorry. There is some disturbances with the network, and we will continue it during the next class. Okay, so we stop at that slide. Anyway, it's already for you 9:05. We will continue during the next class. You can also I'll post the PowerPoint in your Google Classroom. You can go through it, and we can discuss about capacity to contract and contract with a minor during the next class. However, if you want me to continue now for another 15 minutes, I'm willing to do that. What do you want me to do? Yeah, what do you want me to do? Okay. So I take it as that we can, it's okay. That means we can discuss it now or during the next class. Yeah, tell me. Yes, tell me. During this class. Okay, great. That's nice. So we will continue. Thank you for that. Sorry. So we were at this slide. Can you see me? I mean, can you see the slide? Okay, you can see the slide. Okay, so reference to the English law, as per the Family Law Reform Act 1969, a minor is one who is under the age of 18. Under English law, the contract made with a minor may be void or voidable depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case. Voidable contract means that the contract may be declared void at the option of the parties. That means the contract can be regarded as valid or enforceable, and subsequently the parties might say that, well, we're not interested in moving ahead with the contract, so they can make it as void. So know the difference here. You can call that a contract is a valid contract, a void contract, or a voidable contract. Valid contract is a contract that can be enforceable in law. Void contract is a contract that cannot be enforceable in law because it is null and void ab initio, and it cannot be enforceable. Next is voidable contract. That means it can be enforceable at the option of the parties or made void at the option of the parties. So that is voidable. So in UK, contract with minor is not always inherently unenforceable, depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case, but it may be valid and then declared void at the option of the parties. So the law does not forbid contracts with a minor per se. Next is contract for necessaries with a minor. See the term necessaries. So that means it is something pertaining to what is necessary or necessities of life. What is significant? Like, for example, what is a significant necessity? Food, clothing, shelter, water. These are necessaries. Education for a child. These are necessaries. So contract for necessaries with minor in English law, that is for supplies of necessaries or goods and services which are deemed necessary or beneficial to a minor, a contract with a minor is enforceable. If there is a contract with a minor for the supply of necessaries, it is an enforceable contract. It is a valid contract. I'm repeating. Contract with the minor for the supply of necessaries is a valid contract, and it is enforceable in the English law. However, a contract may not be considered as a contract for necessaries if a minor's needs are adequately satisfied and that the purchase made or contracts transacted cannot be regarded significantly as necessaries. That means if the items or the purpose of the contract is not for necessaries, or you cannot call it as a necessary, and it does not come within the bracket of the minor's needs, and minor's basic needs are adequately satisfied. So any additional purchases made, you cannot call it as a necessary. We'll explain this with an example. There's a case example here. However, in Section 3 of the English Sales of Goods Act 1979, it states that when necessaries are sold and delivered to the minor, he must pay a reasonable price for them. For example, a child of, an individual or a child of 12-year-old or 11 years can go to the shop and buy a candy or can buy a notebook. So the necessaries are sold or delivered to a minor, he is expected to pay a reasonable price for them. This is one part of it. Now, to explain what is necessity and what is not necessity, in Nash versus Inman in 1908, Nash was a tailor. He was a tailor working and at a particular place, and Inman was a minor studying at Cambridge University. So this guy, Inman, was known to be from an affluent family, if you go through the exact facts of the case. And this tailor actually sold some clothes, to be precise, waistcoats. He stitched some waistcoats on credit to Inman. And the actual number of waistcoats was 12 in number, 12 in number. And he's, stitched it for him and sold it to Inman on credit. And the approximate amount was around 145 pounds. So Nash now sue to recover the money because Inman later on like was dilly-dallying and did not pay the tailor any charges. So the tailor now he filed a suit against the miner to claim the amount back. So Nash sued to recover the money and Inman pleaded infancy in the sense he said that he was a miner and that it was a contract with the miner. The court held that those waistcoats, actually there were 12 waistcoats in this case, those 12 waistcoats cannot be termed as necessaries. And hence, such a contract cannot be enforced and the plaintiff lost the case, that is, the tailor lost the case. So the question here is whether the contract was for necessaries. If the contract is for necessaries with the minor, it would be regarded as a valid contract. So next is repudiation of a contract, that is, whether the minor can repudiate the contract or terminate the contract. Now, let us explain this concept of repudiation or termination of a minor's contract under common law with an example. Say now P is a university student and he rents out a studio apartment for rent. See, he goes out for studies. Say he goes to some other country to study and is a university student. Where will he stay? Now, so he takes a studio for rent and he lives in an apartment. And later on, he realizes after months interaction, he moves around with his friends. And his friends say like, hey, P, you're paying so much for this studio. In fact, we are paying much lesser than what you're paying. So P gets an idea. Why don't I shift from here? So however, there is a lease contract between P and the flat owner. So now he wants to move for a cheaper flat. Now. The question is, can a minor terminate the contract or repudiate the contract? So the answer to this is a minor can repudiate the contract. However, he's expected to pay for the period for which he has stayed in the studio apartment. So this is normally a general law, under the common laws, that is UK, Australia. So this is applicable. So he can terminate the contract. He's got the right to terminate the contract, but he has to pay for the rent period. Next is the law in Ghana regarding necessaries. Now, referring to Section 2.3 of the Sale of Goods Act of Ghana, it states that necessaries are goods suitable to the condition and life of a person to whom they are delivered and his actual requirements at the time of delivery. So what is a necessity? Depends upon whether it is necessary for conditioning the life of the person or it is suitable to the condition in the life of the person to whom they are delivered and the actual requirements at the time of delivery. Next is now the situation in USA, United States of America, the situation in USA. Now, in USA, we have learned about India, we've learned about the common law, English law, UK, and also it's regarding Australia. And we'll mention about Australia again. But now in USA, contract with a minor is voidable. I told you what is a voidable contract and may be ratified. That means it can be later on subsequently agreed by the minor after he attains the age of majority. So here the minor is allowed the discretion whether or not to proceed with the contract so as to avoid any contravention of minor's rights. That is, avoid any contravention or, to avoid, trespassing minor's rights. His rights as a minor should not be trespassed. So minor has a right to decide on, for example, contraception in USA, right to continue or not to continue pregnancy, etc. So these are some of the rights that are given to the minor, that the minor can decide on their own whether they have to proceed with a particular way of life or whether they want to continue with the pregnancy or not, etc. So that leverage is given under the law in USA for a minor. And the minor can independently go to a doctor and decide upon his or her case. So the minor can void the contract by filing a relevant suit. Now, how can a minor make a voidable contract void. A minor can void the contract by filing a relevant suit in the court of law of appropriate jurisdiction. And in case a minor is defendant, that the minor can take the plea as a minor. So if the minor wants, the minor can make a voidable contract as void at his or her option. A minor's contract and dispute would be handled as per the facts and circumstances of each case and the laws prevalent in each state of USA. Now, USA is divided into states, so each state has a distinct law, and depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case and depending on the laws of each state, the matter would be handled. For example, A is a minor. A, being a minor, misrepresents his age. He does not say the right age. He's a minor, but he says that he's a major. He's about 18, and then he goes to a shop and purchases a laptop and credit. Later, he fails to pay the balance amount. So he pays an advance and some amount is remaining, and he fails to pay the balance. And now the dealer demands a product back. Now, A now returns a damaged laptop. Now, the question is A liable? So the answer to that is, depending upon the state and jurisdiction in USA, A will be held liable for misrepresentation, that he has misrepresented that he is a major, is not a minor. So for that, he'll be held responsible, and also he has to pay for the damages. While in some states in USA, they would say, depending on the jurisdiction, they'll say, no, not required. You have to pay damages because you have misrepresented, but you can avoid the contract. While some other states would say that, no, you have to honor the contract, take your laptop and, you know, pay for it, pay the balance, and also pay for the damages because of the representation. So there are different scenarios depending upon the facts and circumstances of each case and which state in USA it is. So the situation is different. Now here in Canada, Now, in Canada, a minor is an individual below the age of 18, and a minor's contract is voidable even here. Like USA, like UK, a minor's contract is voidable. However, a minor may be bound by a contract for necessities. That means for necessaries, a contract may be enforceable. Now, a minor may ratify a contract upon attaining the age of majority. A minor can repudiate the contract again, also after attaining the age of majority, or he can just repudiate the contract, as I gave you an example about the rent part of it. Now, in Jewell versus Broad, Justice Mueller observed that the general rule is that unless for necessaries, the contract of an infant is not binding upon him. Next, in Australia, the general rule is that the contract with the minor is void, except in limited circumstances where it may be considered as voidable. So it can be void or voidable depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case, and depending upon also the territory within Australia, whether it is New South Wales or Queensland, depends which place it is, and depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case. Now, the situation in UAE, as I said earlier, I've already explained to you, but let us go through the details here. As per the UAE federal law number 5, that is a central law, or in civil transactions law, civil code, all individuals can enter into agreements except minors. That means minor cannot enter into any contracts who do not have the right to deal with the property, and as such, minors are forbidden from entering into a contract. However, with respect to training contracts with a juvenile, a 15-year-old may be granted a work permit for employment or training, and there may be terms and conditions attached to the contract. So you see the difference here. Now that is in UAE. Now, what is the general rule of international law on ratification of minors' contract? What is ratification? Where he agrees to the terms of the contract subsequently. He ratifies, he agrees with the terms of the contract. So general rule of international law on ratification of minor's contract after passage of time, that is, say, after he attains the age of majority, he keeps quiet about, you know, a particular contract. He does not say anything about the contract. So normally, say, a minor's contract is void or voidable, but he keeps quiet. He doesn't say anything after he attains the age of majority. So what is the situation there? So the general rule in case a minor does not ratify a contract and continues to fulfill the terms and a contract continues to exist beyond 2 years of attaining the age of majority, that means how many years? 2 years normally, then such a contract would be considered as ratified and it would be made valid. It would be ratified, that means it's agreed to it and it would be made valid. What about crimes? Criminal law and minor. Of course, you know the answer. No one is exempted from the law in case of crimes. So normally under criminal law, a minor is not exempted and will be charged and put to trial.